The motor car in the hands of the average man is rapidly facing extinction. Truly, the average man is a creature of strange and unorthodox habits. Take the case of Mr. Walker. Mr. Walker lives in a quiet, respectable neighborhood. He is a typical average man, considered a good citizen and of average intelligence. He is a kindly man, courteous, punctual, and honest.
Good morning, Mr. Walker.
Good morning to you, Mr. Geef. Lovely day.
Mr. Walker wouldn't hurt a fly, nor step on an ant. He believes in live and let live. Mr. Walker owns a motor car and considers himself a good driver. But once behind the wheel, a strange phenomenon takes place. Mr. Walker is charged with an overwhelming sense of power. His whole personality changes. Abruptly, he becomes an uncontrollable monster, a demon driver. Mr. Walker is now Mr. Wheeler, a motor.
Hey, Geef, watch where you're going, stupid!
Hey, do you think you're on the hook road?
Of course I own the road. My taxes pay for them. I voted for road bonds. I paid for the roads, and I'll use them. Let him wait. It's a beautiful day. Fresh air. Nice music.
Hey, get over, you roadhog!
Oi. Oi.
Signals. Oh, 30 seconds gone from your life.
Gee whiz. Oh, dear me. Didn't bust it.
Oh, want a race, do they? Well, they ain't gonna get ahead of me.
Good morning.
What luck, a parking place, the motorist's pot of gold. Not everyone has a spot to park in. Deprived of his protective armor, Mr. Wheeler, motorist, becomes Mr. Walker, pedestrian. Of a pedestrian crossing the street, it has often been said, fools step in where angels fear to tread, or... a friend in need is a friend indeed. Where there's a will, there's a way.
Beep.
Here, boy.
Safe. Mr. Walker gains the haven of his car with the knowledge of how the other fellow feels, except once behind the wheel, Mr. Walker reverts to form and again becomes Mr. Wheeler, motorist. Mr. Wheeler, you've broken your toy. But let this be a lesson, Mr. Wheeler. Drive safely. Play fair. Give the other fellow a break and... shut up!
Thank you. Not bad.
Are you feeling better, miss?
How's the wife? How much
fine.
Did it weigh?
Six,
good boy, Geef.
7 or 8 pounds.
Gone, George.
My nose, the wife's hair, mother's eyes, my side of the family looks like. And smart takes after me.
The new father should start immediately sharing the responsibility for the child's upbringing.
Thank you.
Hey, George, here, help me. Oil, cotton, talcum, shirt, diapers, pins, rubber pants. George, the bottle.
The bottle. The bottle. The bottle. The bottle.
George, hurry, wake up. Today's the day baby visits grandma.
Huh? Oh, yeah. Junior going bye-bye.
Although the doting father sometimes doubts he will get through this trying period, the average man usually does, and even looks back with fond memories on such things as baby's first tooth, baby's first step, and baby's first word. Such things past, father feels at last he's earned his Sunday morning snooze.
Oh, it's mine.
I had it
Give
first.
Give it back.
I'll tell my
pa.
Tis isn't.
Hair.
Stop
What's
it.
The matter with that kid of yours?
My kid?
Yes, yours.
Mine had it first.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
George, come in and let the children play.
After a hard day at the office, the tired father wends his weary way homeward.
Junior!
Daddy!
Oof!
What'd you bring? Bang!
Ow!
The child craves the companionship of his father.
There we are.
I don't like it.
Ooh!
Whoopee! Right in
Break a leg?
Uh-huh. Wow!
Playtime over, the tired father relaxes, knowing that his well-mannered child will respect Dad's leisure time and allow father to read the news and smoke his favorite pipe.
Junior, you keep your hands off my pipe.
All right, Daddy. Play football, Daddy?
No.
Play cowboy Indian, Daddy?
No.
Wanna play soldier?
I said no.
Wow.
Junior, pick all those toys up.
No.
What? Didn't Daddy tell you to pick up your toys?
Uh-huh.
Well, pick them up then.
No!
The adult mind must cope with childish innocence and with superior intellect and ingenuity convince the child to obey.
Uh-huh. Now, Junior, don't you pick up a single solitary one of those toys.
All right, I won't.
That's a good boy. Pick up your toys!
No!
Yes!
No!
Yes!
No!
Yes!
George, stop growling at the boy.
I'm not growling.
You'll get nowhere arguing at his level.
But he deliberately said...
Oh, for heaven's sakes, use a little psychology.
Is that fun, Daddy?
Huh?
I'll help too, Daddy.
Ah, yes, father and son working as a cooperative team.
There now. Wasn't that a lot of fun?
Yes, Daddy. Wow!
Daddy, funny!
All right, Junior, time for bed.
All right, Mommy.
I'll teach that kid a thing or two. Where'd he go? Junior!
Here I am, Daddy. Now, look here, young man. I'm going to not...
Good night, Daddy.
Well, what do you know? Look at that. Oh, well. Kids, they're wonderful. I wish I had a million of them.
George, how does this look?
To witness the basketball battle of the century. The whole town has turned out to back the local team from University U, and Polytechnic University from upstate is well supported too. The UUPU rivalry dates back to the beginning of the century, and up to now, the score is even, and tonight's battle is a toss-up between these two squads. Here comes the home squad out onto the floor. Just listen to that crowd. And here comes the visiting team.
Hooray!
Warming up now, and it won't be long before we get underway. Basketball attracts the tall boys, whose great height makes it easy for them to drop the ball through the hoop. These last-minute practice shots are very important to the boys. They like to have their eyes sharpened up for that old bucket. All right, we're ready to go here now. It's a tense moment. The players are anxiously awaiting the outcome of the first toss. Polytechnic coach is giving last-minute instructions to his star player. The referee is picking up the ball. Now both squads are on the court. They line up for the jump. Oh, the tension is terrific. The ball is tipped. Banta has it. Pivoting, he bounces the ball to West, who dribbles and passes to Hannah. Hannah tosses back to West. West to Hannah. Back to West to Hannah. To West to Hannah. To West. The ball's to Banta, the pivot spot. Back to West, waiting for an opening. To Reeves, to Huber, over to... Oh, there's the break. Reeves dribbling the ball past the defense, under the basket. He shoots. It's good. 2 points, and the home team draws first blood. Wright takes it out of bounds, flips it to Banta, over to Reeves again in the pivot position, over to Gracie, to Bird, to Pede. The sharp eyes of the referee sometimes catch things the spectators miss. So let's retrace that last play and view it through the referee's eye. Sibley dribbling. They guard him closely. And he passes to Wright. West has it, dribbling down court. Look at that footwork. Satterwhite gets one free throw. It's up to the referee to make sure that the thrower's feet do not overlap the free throw line. And he makes the point. King tosses into Sibley, who dribbles down court across the center line, pivots and passes to Tobelman in position. And he's... No, Hagen has the ball. He shoots. It's blocked. No, it's no, no, it's no. Yes, it's good. What teamwork. The ball's into Murray, who dribbles past the offensive man. There's a long pass. Gracie has it. He dribbles in and shoots. It's good. Reeves tosses the long one down to Hannah, to West, back to... No, it's intercepted. A shot from the side and good. There's another basket, another and another. They're on the university's basket now. Hannah shoots, good. Reeves shoots, good. There's another shot, and another, and another, and another. All good, and it's tipped in, and that's good, too. Wright has it, dribbling down the sidelines. He's in the clear. Held ball. These UU boys are really on their toes. Reeves takes the ball, dribbles into his front court. Wow, Berg ties him up. But he gets it away. It's in. Right into Berg, over to Gracie, back to Wright. Hannah to Reeves, over the center, into West, to Banta, to Satterwhite. And there's the gun ending the first half. The teams are going to the dressing rooms for that well-earned rest. All set to go again. UU has a 4-point lead as we go into the second half. All right, Brightman gets the ball. He gets to the defense, in the clear, and on his way. The ball's tossed into Kenny. No, it's intercepted by West. What a play. He's in the clear. Hold it. Something's wrong. And Berg leaves the game.
This is a real blow to the coach.
Number 17, Patton, goes in. The ball's in play. The defense closes in. Another PU man out on foul. The coach looks worried. He's losing a lot of good men. Two more men going in. There goes another one. And another. The coach is in a tough spot. All set to go again. Gracie takes the ball out of bounds. His men are covered. What a battle we're witnessing tonight. The score is UU 35, PU 34 with only 1 minute to go. The ball is in the band. It's passed to Gracie, to Frazier, over to Kenny. Pivots over to Reed. Back to... And there's the break. There's a shot. Another. Murray takes it off the backboard. There's a battle going on under UU's basket. Oh, Wright takes it off the backboard. They're down the court. Wow, what a mix-up. They're really fighting now. Only 30 seconds left in the ball game, and the crowd is wild. A scramble under UU's basket, and of the band. West shoots, another, no good, another, not good, another, and it's in. And the old ball game, no, it's not. Yes, no. Wow, what a beautiful defense. He's open for a shot, this might be it. Seconds are rapidly disappearing. 12, 11, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5. Merrithew shoots, and he's in. I mean, it's in. Yes, and there's the final gun. PU 36, UU 35. The upstate boys really came through, and just listen to those PU fans.
Hail to victory for old PU.
To rise. The average man's life is controlled by the clock. It gets him to work on time, home on time, bed on time. Up, work, home, to bed. Up, work, home. This same monotonous pattern continues through the week. But Saturday night, Saturday night, gay, laughing, mad Saturday night. When the average man lets loose, stays up late. And why do you do this, Mr. Average Man? Because tomorrow is Sunday. Your day of rest. Sunday morning. No alarm clocks. No rushing. Complete relaxation.
Father sleep.
All right, Mommy.
You know your father likes to sleep on Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sleeping.
Anyone for tennis? Softly sighing sounds of early morn. Hark, a new day is born. Oh, well, you didn't want to sleep your life away. Now for that old Sunday morning paper. Yep, the coast's clear. Hi, Geef.
Hello there, Mr. Geef.
Morning.
Hello, Geef.
Top of the morning.
Yeah, good to see you, Geef. Hi, Geef. It's truly a day of rest. Lounging around in your pajamas, unshaven. Just plain old loafing.
Come on, come, kids, come on. Get this place cleaned up. I gotta shave. Come on, hurry up. Don't stand there. Get moving. Shake a leg. Come on, I'll get going. Everybody ready?
Well, well, this is a pleasant surprise.
Oh, hello. Come on in.
After a leisurely breakfast, you've got the whole day to yourself. To many, Sunday means tinkering with the car, puttering in the garden, making necessary repairs, or perhaps a little recreation. But to others, it's the day of rest.
George, you promised to drive Junior to the beach.
Come on, Daddy.
Nothing doing. It's my day off, and I'm staying right here.
Ah, the open road and a pleasant Sunday drive.
Drive faster, Daddy!
Stop it, Junior. Lay down, Bowser. Let that alone. Get your hands off of that. Come on, quit pushing. Move over. Stop. Lay off. Junior!
Ooh. All out?
Ah, at last, the beach.
All right, all right.
Hey, here you are. Hey, look at the nice roller coaster. A whoops! Hold on tight. Junior, come back here. Where'd he go? Junior, get out of there.
What's the big...
Well, howdy-do.
Next! Ouch! Oh, no! Now, stop it! Oh, no! Ouch!
Next!
Son of a gun of a doggone thing.
Junior! Junior! Come to Daddy! Wait till I get you!
Reluctantly, you leave the fun zone and hurry to beat the traffic home.
Sunday drivers.
Truly the end of a perfect day of rest.
I want to go home.
But you can take it, because there's always tomorrow. Happy Monday, when you start that wonderful, relaxing humdrum of that good old monotonous week, where you rest up for your day of rest.
ladies and gentlemen, here we are out at the Elite Deluxe Sports Palace about to witness one of the biggest ice hockey games of the season, bringing together two of the top-ranking teams in the league. In no other game is the feeling of competition so keen, affecting both players and spectators alike, turning casual friends into bitter enemies. Tonight's game looks like a sellout. A capacity crowd of thousands of rabid sports-loving hockey fans has turned out to cheer for their favorite teams. Yes, sir, the stands are filling up. They're really packing them in. Well, it seems there have been a few last-minute changes in the starting lineups. Get your pencils ready. Now, instead of Hanna at left wing, Stallings will start. Put DeGrady in place of Williams at center, then Berg over Aliquist. And at left defense, McCormick replaces Dunham. At goalie, Angham takes the place of Nichols. And, oh, yes, the teams will be the Loose Leafs versus the Anteaters instead of the Moose and Pelicans. All right, the teams are skating out onto the ice. Listen to that ovation. And here come the two stars of their teams, Icebox Bertino and Fearless Ferguson. A heated rivalry has developed between these two boys. Both are tied for the top league scoring honors, and tonight's game will be the payoff. As these boys go, so go their clubs. The referee for tonight will be that popular arbiter, Clean Game Kinney. A favorite of the fans. The entire responsibility of the game rests squarely on the shoulders of the referee. This keen-eyed individual must follow the course of play so closely that sometimes it seems he must have eyes in the back of his head. Uh-oh, a penalty. There go the guilty players into the penalty box. With these stars out, the complexion of the entire game may be changed. A hush of expectancy settles over the crowd as the teams line up for the face-off. The referee drops the puck, and the game is on! There's the puck over to the blue line, passed out to the right wing, checked by the opposing left wing, who passes the puck back to the right defense, cutting in fast, picking the puck off the board, now back to the left wing, and pivots around the center. There's a scramble for possession. Boots has got it. He's down the ice, tries for a shot at the net, but the goalie puts up a stout defense, knocking it away for a beautiful save. Comes Colin DeGrady fighting for the puck. There's the shot, and he scores! No, no, no! Look at that stop! Nothing ever gets past that goalie. Jordan Boots is turned down the rink. It's taken by McCormick. McCormick to Papineau with the blue line. Over to Murray. Murray cutting over the Loose Leafs defense. He tries to draw the goalie out of position. There's a shot, and... Save, fella.
What am I saying?
The puck shoots out the center ice. Both teams are battling furiously for possession. Here come Bertino and Ferguson out of the penalty box. And there go Bertino and Ferguson back into the penalty box. The Loose Leafs take the play away. Kyle takes the pass on the right wing. Center ice. Oh, Riley sank the puck in a beautiful poke check at the end. There's a long pass ring wide and a scramble for the puck. A little rough play out there. Both sides are trying to score. And there's the buzzer ending the first period. In order to give the cash customers a chance to sit in their seats, there are 10-minute rests between periods. Starting the second stanza. The team takes to the ice. Puck is faced off. There's a pass out to the side. The Loose Leafs come up with a play. Here comes McCormick cutting down the side. That boy's sure burning up the ice. Spinning like a top, he crosses the blue line. The defense closes in. Wow! They really laid it into him. Come Bertino and Ferguson out of the penalty box. And there go Bertino and Ferguson back into the penalty box. There's a pass out to Bond, and here he comes swinging wide with a blinding burst of speed. Next up is Bond, sliced his way through. Hop shuts in fast, picks up the puck, takes a shot at the net, and the goalie kicks it away. There's another shot, and another, and another. The goalie has the situation well in hand. No, no! He nuts the old net for a score, a score, a score, a score, a score! Anteaters one, Moose leaves nothing. Well, ladies and gentlemen, that score might be enough to put the game on ice. They line up for the faceoff. There's a scramble. The puck is forced against the side. Here come Bertino and Ferguson out of the penalty box. And there go Bertino and Ferguson back into the penalty box. Coming up to the blue line is... Boom! He's right down the crease trying to knock the count. And the goalie boots it away for a Johnson save, and the crowd loses its mind. Here's the play. Mohop checks it away from Williams, intercepted by Shaw, passed behind to Alakos, and slips it to Pede, and there goes right down the middle. He shoots. The referee's in the way. There's another nice save at the net. He clears the puck toward the front, but it's too hot to handle. Now both teams are fighting it out on the ice. This is anybody's game. Riley shoots, McCormick shoots, Berg shoots, Pugley shoots, Weaver shoots, DeGratty shoots, Sepp shoots, Nally shoots, Bushman shoots, Larkin shoots, everybody shoots. There's a score, and another, and another, and another. The goalies are standing their ground, but they've got their hands full. It's a three-scoring game. Shaw is shooting, Moore is shooting, Kobelman shoots, Lowry shoots, Clark shoots, Dolly shoots. The score is piling up. 326, 327, 328, 329, 330, 331, 32, 33, 34. 27, 28, there's never been anything quite like this. The crowd is going absolutely berserk. I've never seen anything but a spectacle. And the crowd loves it. And there's a right cross to the chin. And a left uppercut. And a high one to the center field stand. Oh, a foul, a foul. It's breathtaking. And they're mixing it up. Wow, a basket, a basket. Perry thrust, Perry thrust. Oh, touche. And look at that blocking. And look down the sidelines. It's a touchdown. Strike, ball, ball, strike, ball, strike. He's out. Out like a light. Here comes the pitch. It's a long, low drive. Straight down the fairway. Is it a strike? Is it a strike? No, it's fair. Love that deuce. Rummy, wow, what a performance. What a show. It's every man for himself. And that's why ice hockey is called a spectator sport.
Football needs special equipment. A college covered with ivy, a coliseum or stadium filled to overflowing with 100,000 rabid, wildly cheering fans, great armies of vendors, managers, mascots, photographers, sports writers, doctors, elaborate brass bands, assorted coaches, old grads, scores of Annie Oakleys, and two teams resplendent in brilliant uniforms create a riot of color and atmosphere unequaled by any other game on earth. Now, the object of the game is to pass the ball over the goal line of the opposing team by hook or crook. There are 11 men on either team, two ends, and that's how the game is played. Now the teams line up for the kickoff. The referee blows his whistle, and the game is on. It's a long, high, end-over-end kick over the end zone into the arms of Swivel Hip Smith, that great All-American star, triple threat scat back. Look at him go. They can't touch him. He can really carry the mail, that boy. Look at that open field running. Look at that straight arm. He's away, and he's over for a touchdown. Well, it isn't often you see this happen. 105 yards to a touchdown on the opening kickoff. Now, here's the try for the extra point. And the kick is good. And the score is 7-0. Here comes Swivel Hip Smith out of the game. Listen to that cheer. The coach is saving Smith. He's not taking any chances with his star player. Back to the game. Taxidermy Tech kicks off to Anthropology A&M. But the ball is fumbled, yes, and now it's Taxidermy Tech's ball. They go into a huddle. The quarterback or field general looks over the defense and decides which number to call. They come quickly out of the huddle. The line shifts into position. The quarterback barks his signals. The backfield shifts. The
ball is snapped. The quarterback fakes it to the halfback, gives it to the fullback, who pile drives from center for a gain of 8 yards. And that quarterback's a smart boy.
Oh! All right, signals. 18, 29, 47, 63, 54, 99.
The team's working like a well-oiled machine. It's a double wing back to the right from an unbalanced line, a man in motion, the halfback's got it off tackle, and he's smeared for a 9-yard loss. What a dumb quarterback. To the spectator, football may appear rather rough at times, but in reality, it's a character-building game. All right, taxidermy's ball, third down and 11 to go. DeGrotti has the ball. He gives it to Gershman. No, Sibley's got it. There it goes to right. Oh, no, it's a fake, a hidden ball. Crisscross, cross buck, end around, double lateral, razzle-dazzle, spinner, split buck. And he's in the clear. Uh-oh, there's a penalty on the play. It's against taxidermy tech. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 15 yards for unnecessary roughness. Well, it's fourth down and 26 to go for TNT. The quarterback is worried. The coach radiates confidence. The quarterback decides to kick. It's blocked. No, he got it away. It's a high spiral. The safety man's under it. He muffed it. It's a loose ball. Number 48's in fast. Oops! Butterfingers. Moose Williams got it. He had it. Now DeGrotti missed it. Sebring boots it to the 50. There it goes to the 35. It's next ball. No. Wow. Right. Wrenched it away, and it's A&M's. No, everybody dropped it. Nobody's got it. 100-yard fumble. A free ball over Tech's goal line. But here comes Nordberg. He's recovering the old pork skin for 6. What a play. The teams line up for the try for the extra point. There's the kick, and it's blocked. Anthropology A&M receives, and they're nailed on the 25-yard strike. What's the quarterback going to call? It looks like a pass. It is a pass. Geronimy fades back, cocks his arm, rifles a bullet pass into the flat. It's intercepted by Anthropology. Here's the 40-yard marker, the 30, the 20, the 10, and he's over for a touchdown. There's the try for the extra point. It's good, or is it? Yes, no, yes, no, yes, no, and there's the gun ending the half. Well, here's one for the books. The officials put their heads together, they reach their decision, and the score at the end of the half, taxidermy 7, anthropology 12 and 1/2.
T-A-X-I-D-E-R-M-Y.
During the half, the players are allowed to relax. The coach, who is a master of psychology, points out their weaknesses. To prevent overconfidence, he shames them. Arouses their school spirit. A man of many moods, now threatening, now pleading. A saint, a devil. He has varied and subtle ways of appealing to their sympathy.
Now get out there and fight!
Back on the field, the second half's about to start. Smith's going in. Listen to that cheer. There's the kick. Swivel Hips is under it. A host of anthropologists close in, but he breaks away. 10, 20, 30. Look at him go. 40, 50. They can't stop him. Listen to that crowd. 60, 70, 80. Look at that straight arm. He's in the clear. 90, 95, and he's over for a... Wow! He's hit and hit hard. This is a real blow to the coach. They're taking Smith out. It's a tough break for the team. They're working on Swivel Hips Smith. Tech is snowed under by a wave of tackle. The coach is feverishly trying to revive Smith. Time is running out, and taxidermy is up against a stone wall. Desperately, they work on old Swib. Only time for one more play. Look, it's Smith on his feet. He's going in. The crowd goes wild. Anything can happen. The team's fired up. Here's the play. Smith's got the ball. He's away. Look at that blocking. Smith reverses the field. They're clearing the way. Not a man on his feet. Smith cuts back. The crowd is hysterical. It's Smith tightroping down the sideline. Smith breaks into the clear. But look, there's an anthropology man on his feet. 1 second to go. What a game. And here comes a tackler. Run, Smith, run. Smith's tired. Having trouble with the ball. The A&M man is gaining. He leaves his feet. Look out. Look. And gun, and Smith wins for Taxidermy Tech by half a point. To the coach goes the real credit. It's his clear thinking and calm, level-headed reasoning that makes football the great game it is today.
Common cold is a tiny virus easily identified by his red nose. Although the virus wins few friends, he influences many people. Sometimes the average man seems to deliberately try to catch cold.
That cold out of here.
But boss, look, I don't have a cold. Achoo!
Now look, Geef, a cold is nothing to be sneezed at. Beat it!
Poor Geef, an outcast from society, shunned by a cruel, cold world.
Hello? Achoo! I feel awful. Where is everybody? Huddy, Clay, Bridget, Mabel's. Dinner in icebox. Deserted!
Deserted by the ones he loves the most in his hour of need. Alone with his misery. A definite change has come over this man. He doesn't even look like himself. The top of his head feels like it's blowing up. He feels awful. But man has always been a fighter.
I don't feel good.
Am I ever glad to be home? My, my, what a day.
I'm sick.
Ooh, my feet are just simply killing me. There. That's better.
I've got a cold.
That nosy Mrs. Ripsnoop. Did I ever give her the cold shoulder? She tried to tell me how I should follow suit. I'll bet you'd have enjoyed the game, the second rubber in particular.
I drew the ace, queen, and a beautiful run of hearts. Loveliest hand I've ever filled. Maybe you know the prize. Oh, some silly mini thing.
Heaven knows what I'll do with it. Well. But anyway, George. George, are you listening?
Huh?
I'll bet you haven't heard a single solitary word I've been saying. What on earth's the matter with you?
I got a cold.
A what? Oh, you poor boy. Well, don't stand there like an idiot. Close that window. Bundle up. Get off that cold floor. Jump into bed. Mama's little man don't feel so good. Well, we'll take care of that. We'll break that old cold. Mustn't get chilled. Say ah. You look feverish. Probably just getting a cold. Keep covered up. Nice warm mustard plaster, just the thing. Head. Now some nose drops. There. Feel any relief? Kind of woozy? This should do it. Ah, sleeping like a baby.
So, 2 weeks later, Mr. Geef's cold had run its natural course. And once again, Mr. Geef felt like a human being. Mr. Geef was firmly convinced that a cold is nothing to be sneezed at.
Thank you.
ducks, hunt some ducks, hunt some ducks. I'm a going to hunt some ducks for my fair lady. Good morning. Diddle dum, doodle dee, da diddle dum, ho dee, da diddle dum for my fair lady. Boy, the skies are loaded with them. She works. Hey, where'd she go? Oh, there you are. Okay, Clementine, bring them in. Huh? Something wrong here. Somebody ain't telling the truth. Clementine? Hey, come back here!
Thank you. This could be any town, anywhere, anytime. Because here, just as everywhere else, one-third of the population are aquamaniacs. This is the documented case history of a typical aquamaniac. We shall call him Mr. X. This is his home. But it wasn't always like this. Not so long ago, it was a well-kept, modest dwelling. Promptly at 7:30 every morning, Mr. X said goodbye to his family.
Bye-bye!
So long, Daddy.
And left for work. Always walked, claiming the exercise kept him fit. But this was not altogether true. Secretly, Mr. X liked to walk by a place that sold boats. At first, it seemed harmless enough, but the human body is about two-thirds water. Some believe it's water on the brain that drives a man to boating.
Not me, boy. I got willpower. I can take a boat or leave it. Hey, give me one for the road.
Yes. Just one for the road. How those words have altered men's lives.
Well, son, you're going to learn plenty about the briny blue. I'm going to teach you how to tie knots and show you all about seamanship.
Gee, swell, Dad.
And then I'm going to teach you how to water ski. Hey, avast, you lubbers.
Hey, quit your pushing.
I will bash my binnacle.
Sunday, sailor. What's the matter?
Oh, son.
Hey, knock it off.
Stand by to cast off, matey.
Aye, aye, sir. Anchor's away. Whee! Full speed astern.
Well, keel haul me for a swap.
Yippee, Dad! She's afloat, Dad! Dad! Dad!
Mr. X had much to learn about the ocean. For example, the effect salt water has on metal, etc., commonly called rust.
Where you been, Pa?
Oh, just parking the car, son.
The skis, Dad. Put them on.
Sure, son. And now you're going to see some real fancy skiing. All you got to do is hang on.
Skiers ready on the starting line. You're on the clock. Here's the countdown. Five.
Come on, Dad, hurry.
Four,
you got to get in the race.
Three.
Race?
Two.
What race? Now, wait a minute, son.
They're away. And they're jockeying for position. Wait a minute. Hold it just a minute. Here comes a late starter, and he's closing rapidly. Go ahead. What's speed?
Stop! Stop the boat!
Yes, he is signaling his driver for more speed.
Stop!
Master? Okay, Dad.
Oh.
Making some fine jumps today. Fine. And here comes that Mr. X again. He's boy knows all the tricks that aren't in the book. Wait a minute, Buckkeep. Here comes Mr. X again. A miraculous recovery. Heading into the slalom at a terrific rate of speed. No, he'll never make it. He's going much too fast. Oh, he's magnificent. It's a new speed record for the slalom. Hold on, just a minute. Oh, he just turned. A near catastrophe into a marvelous piece of land. He's slightly off course. Lost sight of him from... George, can you see him from where you are?
Oh! Get me down out of here!
Beginning, the world was all wet. Today, it is still four-fifths wet. Man, the nomad, in the course of his migrations, often encountered bodies of water too wide or too deep to be crossed. Always the thinker, man soon evolved the most primitive form of aquatic transportation. A log. Supported by the log, or seated upon it, the next question was one of propulsion. First the foot, then the hand, and then, the first marine invention, the paddle. From the paddle, the logical development was the oar, which employed the simple mechanics of the lever and fulcrum, producing maximum power with a minimum of effort. Because of the limitless, uncharted expanse of water, the ancient mariner oft-times found himself far, far out at sea, with only the stars to guide him.
Star light, star bright. Guys, I wish I knew where I was tonight.
Swiftly and surely, the stars steered him on to his destination. In the 13th century, even as today, great thinkers worried about what shape the world was in. Some great minds firmly believed that if you sailed west far enough... you would sail off the edge of the world. From the earliest days, sailors were preyed upon by pirates! In those romantic days, ships often changed captains very suddenly. This colorful ceremony was called walking the plank, or feeding the sharks.
Eight bells! Come and get it!
When old Father Neptune went on the rampage, for safety's sake, sailors would lash themselves to the mast. Thus, the sailor was able to stick to his post through hail and high water. The flag is the sign language of the sea. Sailors could communicate with each other by semaphoring and wig-wagging. A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L, M, and O, P, Q, R, S, T, O, E, D, F, 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 he wigged when he should have wagged. The happy, carefree sailor expressed himself with the hornpipe, traditional dance of the sea. Hauling in rope, hoisting sail, rowing, look out, look out! Ah, the clipper ship, the queen of the seven seas, the heyday of sail, Iron Man. Wooden ships. Through centuries of practice, the sailor has developed the perfect set of sea legs. A sailor is easily recognized by his walk. Oh, knots. Who should know how to tie knots better than the sailor? He invented them. The square knot, the sheep shank, the granny knot. A very interesting knot. Bears great strength. The slip knot. Now the barrel knot. Most slip-proof of all.
Take it away!
This explains why sailors are often called old tars. And now, through trial and error, the sailor has at last mastered the sea. A far cry, indeed, from his early ancestors to the modern scientific mariner of today.
All hands, man battle stations, stand by to attack.
Hey! Stand by to attack!
Ready? Aim. Fire!
We'll be right back.
Here we are, Wilbur. You feeling okay? That was a little palsy-welsy. Are you all set? All right, do your stuff.
Me, Wilbur. Here, Wilbur, take a whiff of this. You better watch your step, Wilbur. They're getting wise to you.
Wilbur!
Wilbur. Cough him up.
Rocket.
Hey. Hey, come back here.
Go.
Cheer up. There's lots of grasshoppers in the weeds. But not like Wilbur. Wilbur! Gosh, Wilbur, I thought you was a goner.